Okay, today I'm going to show you some works on lifelong learning, or also it's named as incremental learning. And, well, if you remember the class the last Monday, we did talk about that nowadays and in the past, most the machine learning paradigm is to train the systems independently for each new task that we have. Okay, so we have the paradigm is that we have single task learning, okay, isolated, and we have well-defined tasks. So we want to detect, for instance, objects, and the number of objects is predefined. Okay, and if you want to work in a different task, we are detecting or recognizing faces, we start from the scratch, we get new training data, and we train again a model. Okay, and we don't consider usually the knowledge that we have acquired in other tasks. The last week we saw some methods to transfer the learning from some task to another task. Okay, but in this classical approach, we have the data given prior to training. Okay, so we have some data and then we train. We have all the data before we will train the system. Okay, and usually we need a lot of data to train those systems. Also, usually we train in batch mode. Okay, so the order, the temporal order of the data is not important in this training. Okay, but this is not always the case. Okay, and also we assume that the problem that we are trying to solve is static. For instance, the number of classes is fixed. It is not going to change during the operation of the system. Okay, but in many times this is all these assumptions are not true, and sometimes we don't have all the data before training, but the data can arrive progressively over the time. Okay, so we have new data. For instance, if I work in person identification, so I put a lot of examples of person identification, but in some places you can have new people that you have to recognize, okay? Or the people is changing the appearance over time, okay? So this is new data that you didn't have at the moment of trainings, and you have to solve this problem when it arrives. Another problem is that the memory resources may be limited, okay? And for instance, one thing you could do is each time you have new classes or new data, you could retrain the system. Okay, but this means that if you want to preserve the performance on the old classes, you have to keep the training examples from the old classes. Okay, this sometimes is a lot of needs a lot of memory. You have to keep that, and also it's a lot of computational work to retrain from scratch. Okay, so in lifelong machine learning, we will try not to keep the data examples directly, but to keep a compact or implicit representation. And in neural networks, the models themselves, okay, are a good implicit representation. Okay, so instead of keeping the training examples, we will do from the model, from the weights of a neural network, okay, without keeping the training examples. So that's the idea. Okay. Also, we have another problem is that if we are receiving new data over time, for instance, new classes, whatever, okay, maybe the capacity of the model is not enough. Okay, we have selected a model with a given complexity that it's able to solve the problem at this moment, but if I keep adding classes, new data, whatever, and retraining, maybe this model will not be able to solve all this problem because there's not enough weight, there's not enough layers in this model, okay? So sometimes we will have to increase or change also the model complexity. Of course, you could say, okay, so let's select a very big model so that we will have no problem in the future. But this has economic problems because you need more powerful machines, you have to pay for them in a moment that you maybe you still don't need all this power. Okay? Also, you will have problems with metaparameters because the learning rate, regularization, because this might change when new data arrive. So you will have to turn these metaparameters into parameters. Okay, so you will have to train and obtain these parameters from the data. So let's see what challenges do we have in this lifelong learning. Okay, so to define lifelong learning is like the learning continuously over time, like we do, for instance. I will define it a little bit later. Okay, but the challenge is that if we have data that is arriving over time, okay, let's say that we have trained a model to solve a given task, and now we are using this model. Okay, in the classical approach, we are assuming that the data is static; it's not changing over time. But this is not true. Okay, if I'm recognizing people, the faces of the people are changing because we get older. Okay, so if you do nothing, the performance of the system will degrade over time because the data is changing. Then, also, if you have to adapt this model to new data, we have what it's called the stability plasticity dilemma. Okay, so if you want to adapt to the new classes, you have to modify the model to adapt to these new classes. But this can cause that the model is not longer able to perform properly on the old classes, on the old data. Okay? And you have to balance the adaptation of the parameters to the new data. Okay? If you don't deal properly with this, this dilemma, what you get is what is called catastrophic forgetting. Okay? So this happens, for instance, if you do fine-tuning. If you do transfer learning, simply, what you have is catastrophic forgetting because your model will perform very well on the new data, but really bad on the old data. Okay? So you forgot how to how to work on the old data. Okay? In lifelong learning, what we want is to adapt the models to the new data that is arriving, but also to keep the performance on the previous data. So in lifelong learning, it's the definition is to learn, retain, reuse the knowledge over an extended period of time. Okay? So the data streams are constantly arriving. They are not static. They change. So we need some kind of incremental learning. When new data is arriving, the model has to adapt to this new data. We may have multiple tasks, okay, and those tasks might not be defined at the same time. Okay, so we can have new tasks that are defined over the time, and we want to use the same models, maybe expanded, to solve the new task and the old ones. And we want to retain the knowledge. Okay, to accumulate the knowledge, to be able to reuse this knowledge in the future to ease the learning of new tasks. Okay, so this is more or less a simile of what the humans learn. So this is a graphical explanation of that. In the classical approach, we have several tasks that are isolated. Each one has its data. Okay, and gets a separate portion of knowledge. In the lifelong learning, we take the knowledge that we learn on the previous tasks, okay, and we use this knowledge to learn the new tasks. There are, of course, some related approaches. Okay, in the last week, we saw the transfer learning. In the transfer learning, we have a source and a target domain, and the we have some model that has been trained on the source domain, and we use this this model to help learning the data in the target domain. Okay, so we need, for instance, less data in the target domain. This assumes more or less that the tasks are related or similar. Okay, another related approach is multitask learning. In multitask learning, several tasks are learned at the same time. Okay, so all the tasks have some labeled data and are treated in the same way. And the goal is to optimize the learning or the performance across all the tasks. Okay? Sorry. So this is those approaches are related to lifelong learning, but they are not the same. There are some differences. For instance, in the transfer learning, the transfer is unidirectional. So we are transferring the knowledge from the source to the target tasks, okay? But we lose the ability to perform properly in the original domain, okay? We don't care about the original domain. Also, this is not continuous. This is one step, another step, okay? So there is no flowing information over time. So it's at one step we decide to adapt the model, okay? But if the data changes, we have to perform another adaptation. So this is no retention or accumulation of knowledge, just a transfer of the knowledge. The other approach, multitask learning, assumes that the learning is performed simultaneously. So we have different tasks, but the learning process is made at the same time. So we learn all the tasks at the same time, and we need the data, the training data for all the tasks in this process. Okay? This is not the idea in lifelong learning, where we have this first, this temporality. We want to work in a progressive way. Okay? And we don't want to store the data, the training data for the old tasks. So let's see some of the methods for that have been appearing in the literature for lifelong learning. Okay, first I want to. Most of them are based on what is called distillation. Some of them, at least, goes in distillation. I did introduce distillation in the last class, in the last month's week class. Okay, and if you remember, distillation is a concept that did arise when people were trying to transfer the knowledge from a big network to a smaller network. Okay, so why we want to do that? Because sometimes larger networks are easier to train. Okay, it's easier to train a very large network than a small one in a complex problem. Okay, if the problem is also small, it's better to use a. But let's say that we have a complex problem and we train a large network, but then at test time, at the production time, what we want is to reduce the computational resources that you need. If we want to implement this into an autonomous car or in a drone or whatever, what we need is a very compact network that can work fast, cheap, and with a small memory. Okay? So one thing that we can do is to transfer the knowledge from this network to this one. We don't work directly, we don't train directly this one, because it's much more difficult to train a small network than a big one in a complex problem. Okay? It's easier to train on the larger network and then to transfer the knowledge. And there are some works that did demonstrate that it is possible. Okay? And one of the most successful ways to do that was proposed by Hinton and Oriol Vinyals some years ago, and it's based on this the concept of distillation. So the idea is that you have the large model, you train the large model in the classical way, using, for instance, if it's a classification problem, you use multinomial logistic loss on the one hot encoded labels. Okay, so you learn this. And once you have trained this model, what you do is you take, for instance, the training samples, and you pass the training samples through the network. And you keep the softmax activations, the, let's say the probabilities, for all the training data, okay, on the network that it's at in the, its final state. Then, to train the smaller network, what do you, instead of using this same approach, we use the distillation loss. The distillation loss is very similar to the multinomial logistic loss, but instead of using the hard labels, the one hot encoded labels, we will call these hard labels, we use the soft labels. We use the labels of the training samples when when has been processed by the larger network. Okay? So what we do is to compute this loss. This way, what we can do is to train the smaller network with much less complexity, having much less training samples, and this network can achieve the same, almost the same accuracy of the larger network, okay, with a lot less of number of parameters, okay, and the training is also faster. And this is why, because the soft activations, the soft max activations, remember that those are the probabilities, not only tell us the best class, the best result, but also for the non-selected probabilities, the ratio between the probabilities give us some information about the structure of the problem. Okay? And it has been demonstrated that doing that can speed the training of the smaller network. Okay. So remember, this concept was invented to transfer the knowledge from a large to a smaller network. But in lifelong learning, it can be used to keep the information for all data when learning new data. Okay. In distillation, sometimes we are using a small trick that is when you compute the softmax activation in the last layer, we use this temperature parameter, and we can increase the value of T. Usually this value of T is 1 for the standard softmax. Okay, but if you increase the value of this T, what you get is softer labels. Okay, so the labels, instead of, for instance, if you look at this, it's 0.85, 0.05, 0.09. Okay, if you compute the same with T equal to 5 or T equal to 10, what you get is another set of probabilities, and now the probabilities are much more similar. If you look at this, the largest probability has decreased and the smaller probability has increased. Okay? And this gives more importance to the probabilities of the smaller classes. Otherwise, those probabilities could be too small to have any influence. It could be near zero. Okay? If you have this problem, you can increase the value of T to rearrange the probabilities. Okay? Okay. So let's see the first method that I will explain you today, that it's called learning without forgetting. It's from around 2 years ago. And the idea is that you want to add new prediction tasks based on adapting the parameters of the network without any access to the previous labels. Okay, so you want to train on new data, for instance, new classes. Okay. But you don't have the original training examples from the original classes, okay? And of course, you want to preserve the performance over all the classes, the old and the new, okay? So what we'll do, and What we have is some examples from the new classes, some labeled data for the new classes. Okay. So we will use these samples from the new classes to keep the performance on the previous task and to obtain high accuracy in the new task. This is, and one thing about that is that we don't need to change the storage necessity or the complexity because we are not keeping the all training data. And we are not training the network from scratch with the new and old. We are adapting the weights to the new training data without forgetting the old ones. So let's assume that we have a model that has been trained in a different number of tasks. Okay? So the model has a shared parameters, and the shared parameters to do to put an example could be the convolutional part in a convolutional neural network. And let's say that we, for instance, we have several task-specific parameters that could be, for instance, some fully connected layers, one for each different task that we want to solve. And this has been trained in the past, and we have this. Okay, so we have some one model that can work on different different tasks. Okay, so now we want to add, for instance, a new task. We have some ground truth for this new task, and what we do is, for the new task, we will initialize the task-specific weights. Okay, and for the shared weights, we will perform a fine-tuning. And we will do that for the, also for the older tasks so that we can preserve the performance on the older tasks. So we will perform fine-tuning on the older and the new tasks. Okay, but remember, to perform this fine-tuning, we only have examples from the new classes that are for this task. Okay, not for those ones, because we are not keeping the older data. So how we can perform fine-tuning on this without having examples of for these tasks? So the idea is that we will use a new loss function that is a combination of two different loss functions. Okay, for the new task, we will use the usual, the multinomial logistic loss. Okay, we have some ground truth data, so we can use this, and this term is just the training of this. Okay, but for the older tasks, what we can do is to take the new training data, to pass this training data over the network and to record the and record the softmax labels, okay, so the soft labels. And then we can perform distillation. We use the distillation loss on this. Okay? So for the all tasks, these ones, okay, those are the all tasks. We can perform fine-tuning, but using the softmax activations on the new training data. Okay? This way, and remember this. The data is new, so it's not data that is specific for those tasks, but the distillation, remember, the effect of distillation is to preserving the relationship between the different classes. Okay? So this alone can help to preserve the performance on the older tasks. Also, a weight decay is added to regularize the output. Okay, so the idea is that we are combining this new data with preserving the response on the network. Okay, on the and the way of preserving the ability of the network to work on the previous training data is to keep more or less use the new data to keep the structure, the relationship between all the classes in the problem. Okay, another very similar method is what is called iCarl. In iCarl, it's assuming it's very similar to the previous one, but this method is assuming that you have some restricted ability to keep data from the older tasks, the training data from the older tasks. Okay, so in this case, we are assuming that we have an incremental learning approach. We have some new classes that can arrive over time. So we have a task, and this task is not closed because we have at each time, for instance, we have new people that we have to recognize. Okay? And what the difference with the previous with the previous system is that we can keep some examples of the previous classes, okay? And then we will use this small set of examples from the previous classes to keep the performance in the older tasks, okay? So now that the training set will be a combination of the new samples and the some previous samples. Okay, so we have new data, labeled data for the new classes that are arriving, and we will have some examples of the previous classes. And in this particular work, they kept the size of the exemplar set, the number of training data, constant. Okay, so as the number of classes is increasing over time, we have more and more classes, they delete some of the examples from the old training data so that the size of the number of examples that you keep from previous classes is constant. So here the idea is that first you have a system like in the previous case and you want to update the system to the new data, the new classes. Okay, to do that, you use the same combination of classification loss and distillation loss, okay, exactly as before. But now what we are using is the new training data for the new classes, okay, as before, and for the previous classes we are using the exemplar set, okay, the set of examples from previous classes, the restricted set of examples, okay? As we have only a few examples from the previous classes, okay, the distillation will help to improve the learning or to keep the learning that we had on the previous classes, okay? If we did use the standard classification loss here, using hard labels, okay, this small number of labels will not be enough to keep the information from the previous classes. Okay, by using this distillation loss, the process is more efficient and we can keep the knowledge from the previous classes. Okay, and now we are using the classification loss, remember, on the new classes with the new data, and the distillation loss using the previous examples. Okay, remember that in the previous case we did only have new data from the new task or the new classes. Okay, so we didn't have this. Okay, so we always did use that. Now we have some exemplars from the previous classes, but the idea is very, very similar. And as I told you, the authors wanted to keep the storage constant over time. So when they had this new the exemplar set, the examples from all classes, okay, now we have new data that is arriving, new classes, okay. So what they do is to delete some of the examples from the new classes. So at the end, we had in this exemplar set, in this case, six examples and from two different classes. And after arriving a new class, we have to delete some of the older examples to keep constant the number of training examples, that is, number of old training examples. Okay? So the idea is not to increase the storage necessity of the system. Okay? Any questions? So basically, the idea is the same, but in this case, you have some old data to keep the process. If you look at the examples, this is some work that one of our students did some time ago. Okay, of course, the iCarl, it's much better at preserving the accuracy on the new and old class, especially on the old classes. Okay, so this is an example in face recognition, and this is the number of classes that we keep adding. Okay, at each point we add some new classes, and as you can see in the, well, I think this is multiplied by something, it's not 8 or 9 classes, it's much more. If you look at this, iCarl having access to some data from the older classes, okay, it's able to preserve the accuracy, okay, in the new and also in the old. I think that green, it's, no, blue is the old classes, okay. The orange is the new classes, and the green is the overall performance. So it's composed of the performance over new and old classes. Okay, if you look at this, this more or less can keep the performance. On the other side, learning without forgetting, it's much better to keep the performance at the new classes, but you get some degradation for the old classes. Of course, you can tune this, because you may add here some parameters to balance the learning between new and old. Okay. Okay. Let's go for a different method that is called elastic weight consolidation. And the idea here is that when you learn a set of when you train a network, okay, you are learning a set of parameters, okay, but there is not a single solution for that. For the set of parameters that you will learn, okay, remember you have a lot of different parameters. You usually, if you train from scratch, you are initializing randomly these parameters, and you perform the training process several times, you will obtain several different results, more or less similar, but different. Okay, so there is not a single solution for the training process. There is some you can have more than one solution. Okay, so let's say you did train a network for a given task. Okay, and this is the, let's say, a representation. This point is a representation of a multidimensional representation, a point that represents the parameters that you learn, and the ellipsis here, it's the all the possible parameters that can solve the problem A. Okay? When you learn the problem B, let's say that the yellow ellipsis is the set of the locations of the set of possible parameters that could solve this new problem B. Okay, so what you want is to select a single set of parameters that solve task A and task B. So what you can try to do is to force the learning so that the actual set of parameters that will decide is compatible with both the set of solution for A and the set of solution for B. If you don't do nothing, when you train for B, you are moving the parameters, you are adapting the parameters, and these parameters could go to any of the possible possible solution for problem B. Okay? And in the elastic weight consolidation, we will try to constrain this adaptation of the parameters so the new parameters are both compatible with problem A and problem B. And the idea here is that we will try to preserve the value of the most important parameters for task or for problem A. Okay, so we have to identify which parameters with which weights in the network are most important for problem A, and we have to avoid disturbing too much those parameters. Okay, so this can be done by using also a new loss function, that it's a the classical loss function that tries to adapt the problem, the network to problem B, okay? But we keep like a spring that tries to fix the parameter to the value that it's useful to solve the problem A, okay? So if this is the new the new values of the parameters, and this is the old parameters that were trained for task A, what you do is to add a factor in the loss function that minimizes, okay, the change in the important parameters. Okay, and the important not all the parameters are equally important. So the most important one are selected by a special process that they compute the Fisher information matrix. Okay. So by doing that, you make sure that the parameters at the end will be compatible with both problem A and problem B. Okay? And of course, you can balance the effect on just learning B. If you only do that, okay, if you only use that, so if lambda is equal to zero, you are only considering the learning on or adapting this model to the new problem B. Okay? If you have a large value of lambda, what you do is to put a strong restriction and keeping the model very similar to the solution for that you had for model A. Okay? But balancing this, you can decide between adaptation and keeping the old parameters. Okay, another solution, still another solution. Progressive neural networks, okay, so let's say that you have a set of tasks, different tasks, okay, and you want to reuse the knowledge. And here different tasks may be, for instance, that for once you have one network that has been trained for face recognition. Now you want to do face expression analysis, okay? So in progressive neural networks, a new neural network is instantiated for each task that you want to solve. For instance, you start with the first one. This is a network, okay? You train the first network from the scratch, for instance. You have a network that has been trained to solve face recognition in a set of classes. Now, when you have a new task, what you do is to add a new network, but to keep the old knowledge, what you can do is to add some lateral connections between the layers. By adding these lateral connections, what you do is that this layer can use, of course, the previous layer, the previous layers, but also the previous layers from the other task. Okay? Of course, when you are training the second task, you will only modify the weights for this task, and these ones will keep frozen. Okay? So you are learning only this, but this has the benefit that it can access to the layers in other tasks. Okay? And if you add a third one, it will have some connections with the first two of them. Okay, so at the end, that the function at each at each layer that you have. It's a combination of the weights of the previous layer, but also of the combinations of the lateral layers. Okay? And remember, in the training process for this layer, you will adapt those weights, but not those ones. Those are fixed when you are training this one. Okay? So you don't need the training data for the previous tasks, but what you have is a new network for each different task that we want to solve. So here there is an increase in complexity. So we have more complex setup each time we add a new task. This, well, can be useful because we are sure that we will never run, that our model will not be too simple at a given point. Okay, we can keep adding some complexity. Okay, on the other side, the model will keep growing over time. So if you have some restrictions at the end, if you have a lot of different tasks, you will have ending having a very, very complex model. Okay. And another problem is that you need what is called task labels. Okay, so when you want to use that, of course, if you want to do fair recognition, you have to go to forward your data through this network. If you want to perform face expression, you will have to pass the data through this network. So you need to know if your data is for face recognition or is for face expression analysis. Okay, so this is a task label. Another method is called deep adaptation. It's similar to the previous one, but tries to remove the increase in complexity that has the progressive neural networks. Okay, remember that in progressive neural networks, we need a new network for each task. Okay, in deep adaptation, what is done is to use a common model, okay, and a neural network, and then for each layer of this neural network, a controller is is added. Okay, so these controllers are ways of combining the weights in this neural network. So in fact, this is the weights here are frozen, and those layers are used only as a set, like a set of bases. Okay, so in fact, this controller will use that for a combination or a linear combination of or non-linear combination of the weights in these layers. Okay. The idea is more or less the same. You also need the class labels because you, for each class, you will have a different controller, a set of controllers. But in this way, you are reusing those weights, okay, with a smaller set of new parameters. Okay, the number of parameters in this approach, it's smaller than in the previous approach. Okay, so what you need is the parameters for the controller that you will learn in the new tasks. Okay, but remember that these parameters are just controlling the way that you are using the weights in the main network. Okay, they have some details here, but more or less this is the idea. Okay, so this way the important thing is that the increase in complexity is more or less 20-30% of the number of weights of the original, of the base layer. Okay, and remember, in the progressive neural network, the increase in complexity was 100% of the weights for each new task. Okay, so this is more or less a summary of the different properties of these different approaches that I have been showing you. Okay. Regarding if they need the previous training data, or if the complexity is increased, or the storage is increasing over time or not. Okay. Well, let's go just for a moment for here. Another problem that we may have, remember, is that over time, the complexity of our system is not enough. Okay, we keep receiving new data, and the problem gets more and more complex. So the network that I designed for the originally is not enough to solve the enlarged problem. Okay, another method to do that is to increase the number of neurons or the number of layers in our network. Okay, so we want to start with a small model and keep growing this model without having to retrain this model. Okay. We know that it's possible to transfer knowledge from what is called a teacher network to a bigger student network. Okay, so now we have a small network. We want to pass this knowledge to a bigger network. Okay, so it's the inverse problem that the one that we had in distillation. Okay, in distillation we had a bigger network. We want to transfer the knowledge to a smaller network. In this case, what we want to do is to take a network that is at the limit of its capacity and to transfer all the of the knowledge to a larger network that will be able in the future to learn the more complex tasks. Okay? So one way to do that is what is called net to wider net. Okay? So the idea is very simple. You start with the teacher network, you have this network that has been learned. These are the neurons, okay? And you want to enlarge, make this more complex so that it can learn more complex problems, okay? So the idea is that we take one of these neurons at random, and this neuron is duplicated. So let's say that we duplicate this neuron, okay? Now, if we want to preserve the ability of this network to work on the previous data, on the previous problems, what we can do now is to, well, we keep adding the lateral disconnections, okay? And now, if you look at this weight, we can divide this weight by 2. Okay? So at the end, the function that is solving this new enlarged neural network is the same as this one. Okay, because we did replicate this neuron, but we are halving the weight in the output. Okay, so instead of one neuron, we have 2 neurons that are identical. So it will the influence of these 2 neurons will be the double of the first one, but now we halve the weights. Okay, it's quite simple. And now, from now on, okay, we have a more complex system that in the future can be retrained to learn more complex problems. Okay? But in the old data, the effect will be the same, the accuracy will be the same. Okay? So there is no change at this point. Okay? The change will come at the future because this we have more neurons, so this is a more powerful neural network. Okay, if you have a convolutional neural network, what you can add is more convolutional channels. Okay, but in the same way. Well, this is the explanation on how it is done. Okay. And finally, another problem that you may have in the lifelong learning is how to discover the new classes and how to train for these new classes. Okay, so until now we did assume that the new classes will be discovered by some human, and this human will say, "Okay, you have to," will tell to the network, "you have to incrementally learn these new classes. Okay, but what if the network itself could detect that, oh, this new data doesn't fit in any of the classes that I have, maybe we have to define a new class. Okay, so that's the idea in this algorithm. Okay, that it was thought before. It's not for specific for deep learning. Okay, you can do that on support vector machines. And the idea is that you have new classes, new concepts that are arriving, and we have to discover automatically these new classes or concepts. And this WALI system, it incorporates four different phases. Okay, first one is watch. So the system is receiving a continuous flow of data, and in this case, YouTube videos. Then ask. The system at some points decides that a given image, in this case, doesn't fit, or something in the image doesn't fit into the classes that it already has, and then ask for manual annotations. Okay, the annotations are manual, so it's not complete autonomous learning. So selects a few examples and asks some human to say, okay, can you annotate these examples? A few examples, okay? And then using the new examples, it can learn, okay? And improve, okay? So this is repeat to improve the learning. And, well, some details. You can extract some descriptors and try to classify the images into a set of classes that you have. Okay, then you have to decide some way that this image doesn't fit into the classes that are already available. So that can be done by computing the best versus second best scores. Okay, so you compute the score for the best class and the score of the second best class. Okay, if this is too small, it means that you are not very sure on your classification. Okay, because if you are very sure on your classification, the score of the best class and the score of the second class are very different. If they are similar, it means that you can easily make a mistake between the first and the second class, and then in these cases the ones with the smaller Q are selected to be labeled by humans. Okay, and then using that, after that you can use some kind of incremental learning, for instance the method with distillation or whatever, to retrain the classifiers with the new samples. Okay, so this is a process that can also discover new classes. Okay, there are some references that are in the slides. And if you have some questions, I will be glad to answer them. Okay, so thank you very much, and see you during this course.